Assalamu alaikum students, welcome back to another video. Today we will be solving Cambridge IGCSE Physics Paper 4 variant 42 of October-November 2022. Also a quick reminder that all of the revenue generated from these videos will be sent to the aid of our Palestinian brothers and sisters. So please support us. Question 1. Figure 1.1 shows sea water flowing down a channel into a tank without splashing. The water is flowing at a rate of 800 kilograms per minute. The length and width of the tank are 3.1 meters and 1.2 meters. The density of the seawater is 1020 kilograms per meter cube. Initially the tank is empty. Calculate the depth of water in the tank after 1 minute. Give your answer to three significant figures. So in order to calculate the depth, we will need the volume. Since we are given the length and width, we will need the volume to calculate the depth. So we know the formula, density is equals to mass upon volume. Density we know is 1020, mass we know is 800 kilograms per minute, volume we have to calculate. So when you put this in your calculator, 800 divided by 1020, you will get 0.784, which is your volume. So we know 0.784 is our volume. We are given the length and width, 3.1 times 1.2 times the depth. So we have to calculate the depth. So just make depth the subject here, bring 3.1 and 1.2 to this side, divided by 0.84. And you will get your answer as 0.211 meters. So this is your depth. The height of the water decreases by 0.42 meters as it falls down the channel. Calculate the decrease in gravitational potential energy of the water each second. So we know the formula for gravitational potential energy, it is mgh. The mass of the water we are given as 800 kilograms per minute, but here be careful, you will have to calculate each second. So you will have to convert the minutes into second. So 800 divided by 60, gravitational field strength is always 10, height we are given 0.42. So just put this in your calculator and the answer you will get would be 56 joules. Part C. The water stops flowing. The depth of the water in the tank is 0.8 meters. Calculate the pressure at the bottom of the tank into the water. So we know the formula for pressure exerted by a liquid is rho gh. So we know all three values. Rho is the density, which is 1020. Field strength is 10, height is 0.8. So the answer comes out to be 8200 pascals. Question 2. A pendulum swings with a time period of approximately 1 second. Describe how to use the stopwatch to determine the time period of the pendulum. So here what you can do is that you can record the time for 20 oscillations and then divide by 20. And then you will get the time period of the pendulum. So let's suppose this is your pendulum. So one oscillation would be back and forth. So this would be one oscillation. So you can measure the time for 20, record the time for 20 oscillations and then divide by 20. And then you'll get the answer for time period. So you can write, you can use stopwatch to time 20 oscillations. Doesn't have to be 20, it can even be 10 or 15. So this way you will get the time period. Complete table 2.1 by writing in each space of the right hand column which one of the following devices is used to measure the quantity in the left hand column. So volume of water in a glass, it will obviously be measuring cylinder, because there is no other option which measures volume. Width of a small swimming pool, so it can either be done by a meter rule or a micrometer screw gauge. So it is very obvious as it is a swimming pool, so it will obviously be meter rule. Micrometer screw gauge is used for very small measurements, like a thickness of a piece of aluminium foil, that will be used using micrometer screw gauge. Question 3. Tidal power derives most of its energy from the moon and part of its energy from the sun. State one other source of power which derives its energy from the sun. So you can write any option, like solar energy is through the sun. State one source of power which does not derive its energy from the sun. Here also you can write anything, any correct relevant answer, like nuclear. You could have written geothermal as well. Figure 3.1 shows a small water turbine driven by a tidal flow of water to generate electrical power. Explain whether this method of generation of electrical power is renewable. So yes, it is renewable. Because it is available all the time. We will never run out of tidal power because the sun and moon will always be present and tides arise due to the moon. So tidal power will always be present. It is something that we will never run out of. The mass of water passing through the turbine each second is 6 into 10 to the power 3 kilograms. The speed of the water is 2 meters per second. 40% of the kinetic energy of the water is converted to electrical energy. Calculate the electrical power generated. Okay, so first we have to calculate the kinetic energy. So half mv square, mass is 6000, speed is 2 meters per second. So this comes out to be 12,000 joules is the kinetic energy, and they tell us that 40% of the kinetic energy of the water is converted to electrical energy. So 40% of 12,000 would be 40% of 12,000 gives us 4,800 joules. So the electrical power, we know the formula of power is energy over time. Energy we know is 4,800. Time they have told us each second, so 1 second. So it gives us final answer of 4,800 watts. Question 4. Explain in terms of the momentum of particles how a gas exerts a pressure. So we know that when particles move, they collide with the wall, and as they collide, the momentum changes, and hence force is exerted by those particles due to the change in momentum, and pressure is the total force of particles per unit area. So we can write it as particles momentum, a force is exerted, and we know that pressure is force upon area. So obviously when a force is exerted, a pressure will also be exerted. Pressure is related to force. Part B. The temperature of a sample of gas is increased at constant volume. State and explain any change in the pressure of the gas. So we know that temperature and pressure are directly related. So when the temperature is increased, the pressure increases as well. Pressure increases because as the temperature increases, particles or the particles gain energy, kinetic energy. Frequency as well, so that causes an increase in pressure. Another sample of gas is in a sealed container of 170 cm³ and exerts a pressure of this much. The volume of the container decreases by 70 cm at constant temperature. Calculate the new pressure of the gas. So we know the formula P1V1 is equal to P2V2. So P1V1 is 170 times 9 × 10⁴ P2 we have to calculate, and V2 is 70. So just put this in the calculator and your answer will come out to be this much. Question 5. Figure 5.1 shows an aluminum block after leaving a furnace in a factory. The mass of the block is 1200 kilograms and it is heated in the furnace from 20 to 380 Celsius. The aluminum block does not melt. The specific heat capacity of aluminum is 960 joules per kilogram Celsius. Calculate the thermal energy gained by the block in the furnace. So we know the formula. Energy is equals to mc delta t. So the mass of the block is 1200, specific heat capacity is 960, and change in temperature is 360. So the answer is 1.1 × 8 joules. Figure 5.1 shows a factory worker standing 3 meters from the block. Should it explain the main process by which thermal energy is transferred to the worker? So we know that they are not in direct contact. So thermal energy is transferred through thermal radiation. These waves travel, they travel through air since they do not need a medium. They travel through air and then interact with the worker. without medium. Part C. State and explain the main process by which thermal energy is transferred from the outer surface of the solid metal rollers to their interior. So this is through conduction, because they are obviously in contact with each other. And how does conduction occur in metals, since aluminum is a metal? Through two ways. One is through free moving electrons, delocalized electrons you can call them, and the other way is the vibration, the lattice vibration of the particles. So they collide with each other, or they vibrate at their fixed position, and then they transfer energy from one particle to the other. Transfer energy to the neighboring particles. Question 6. Figure 6.1 shows a converging lens in an object OX. The focuses of the lens are labeled F. On figure 6.1, carefully draw two rays from X which locate the image of the object. Draw the image and label it IY. Okay, so we need to make two rays, one that travels through the focal lens and one that travels through the center. So they will converge somewhere over here. This will be your IY. Measure the distance from IY along the principal axis to the center of the lens. So you have to measure this distance, and you will do this using a calculator, and the answer should be somewhere in between 36 millimeters and 44. This is the range. This is in millimeters. State two reasons why the image IY is virtual. So we know that that when the images are formed on the same side of the lens, so those images are virtual. And when the object is closer to the lens, is less than one focal length closer to the lens. So this is your focal length. This is your focal length F, and the object is closer to the lens, less closer than one focal length. So in that case, images are formed virtual. Figure 6.2 shows the ray of green light passing into, through and out of a glass prism. A ray of blue light is incident on the prism on the same path as the incident ray of green light. On figure 6.2, draw the path of the blue light through and out of the prism. So we know that blue light has a shorter wavelength as compared to green light. So shorter wavelength means that it will diffract more. It will have a greater angle of refraction. So the incident ray will be the same, but inside the prism it will begin to refract, and outside the prism it will be greater. This will be a blue light. Question 7. This question is about the magnetic fields around bar magnets. Figure 7.1 shows two positions used by a student doing an experiment. Figure 7.2 shows a magnet labeled 1 placed on position 1. Figure 7.2 shows a magnet labeled magnet 1 position 1. In figure 7.2, draw lines to show the pattern of the magnetic field produced by magnet 1. Place arrows on the lines to show the direction of the field. So we know that magnetic field lines travel from north to south outside the magnet. Magnet 1 is removed from position 1. Figure 7.3 shows another magnet labeled magnet 2 placed on position 2. On figure 7.3, draw the right hand end of position 1, align with an arrow to show the direction of the magnetic field produced by magnet 2. So we know that it will be in this direction. Part C. Figure 7.4 shows magnet 1 placed in position 1 and magnet 2 placed in position 2. State the direction of the force that the north pole of magnet 2 exerts on the north pole of magnet 1. So we know that they are the same pole, so we know that same poles, they repel each other. So the force would be in this direction. They would be repelling each other. To the left of magnet 2, because they repel each other. Question 8. Figure 8.1 shows an electrical circuit. Light intensity of the circuit increases from dark to bright. State any effect on the resistance of component wire. So we know that this is a light dependent resistor, and when the light intensity increases, the resistance decreases. So resistance decreases. Share and explain any effect on the reading of the voltmeter. So obviously if the resistance decreases, the potential difference across it will also decrease, and the reading on the voltmeter will also decrease. The circuit shown in figure 8.2 is switched on for 2 minutes. The current in the 4 ohm resistor is 3 amperes, and the magnitude of the charge on an electron is this value. Calculate the number of electrons that pass through the resistor each second. So what is the formula? I is equal to charge over time, and we want the number of electrons that pass through each second. So current we know is 3. Charge we have to calculate, so n times 1.6 into 10 to the power 19, and time we know is 1 second. So bring the value of the charge to the left side and divide by 3. So this will give us 1.9 to 10 to the power 19 electrons. Calculate the power dissipated by the resistor. So we know the formula for power dissipated is P is equals to VI, where V is the potential difference and I is the current. So we know V is 12 volts, current they have told us is 3, so this is 36 watts. Question 9. Draw the symbol for a diode. So this is easy. Diode is drawn like this. A NOT gate is drawn like this. Okay, so these parts are out of the syllabus. So we will not attempt this part C as well. They are not in your syllabus anymore, so we will not be attempting these. Moving on to question 10, and this is the last question of the paper. The magnitude of the charge on a beta particle is 1.6 into 10 to the power 19, which is also the charge of an electron. State the proton number and the nucleon number of an alpha particle. So we know the alpha particle is of this nature. So proton number is 2 and nucleon number is 4. Determine the magnitude of the charge of an alpha particle. So we know that an alpha particle has 2 protons, and this also is an indication that it will also have 2 electrons, because the number of protons and electrons are always the same. So 2 electrons, it means 2 into 2. Nucleus of radium-230 consists of 88 protons and 142 neutrons. Radium-230 is radioactive and decays by beta emission of an isotope of actinium. The symbol for radium is Ra and the symbol for actinium is Ac. Write down the nucleide equation for this decay. So they have told us that beta decay is occurring of a radium particle, radium atom. So radium has this symbol and it decays into an actinium particle or atom, and since it is beta decay, this is how you will write it. The half-life of radium-230 is 93 minutes. A sample contains 9.6 into 10 to the power minus 12 grams of radium-230. Calculate the mass of radium in the sample after 279 minutes. So 279 minutes is 3 half-lives. So after 1 half-life, this would become 4.8 into the power minus 12. After the second half-life, this would become 2.4 into 10 to the power minus 12. And after the third half-life, this would become this much. And this will be your final answer. So So that brings us to the end of our paper. I hope you liked this video, and if you did, please leave a like and subscribe to our channel, and I will see you later.